I'm Dan Foster, Superintendent of Schools for Caston School Corporation. On Sunday, June 3rd, the Caston School Corporation honored its first class of distinguished alumni. Distinguished alumni are Caston graduates, living or deceased, who have led successful lives while making substantial contributions to their chosen field of work or have provided outstanding service to their community, state, or country. The class of 2012 consists of six Caston graduates from the 1960s, 1970s, 1980s, and 1990s. During the June 3rd Induction Day activities, the inductees were welcomed with an appreciation reception. It is anticipated that during the next school year, each inductee will make presentations to groups of students in which they share their high school, career, and life experiences. This should prove to be beneficial time for the students of Caston Junior Senior High School and perhaps even Caston Elementary School, as the students learn about the outstanding accomplishments of these distinguished alumni. The desire is for students to realize earning a diploma from Caston High School was an important initial step in the successful life of each inductee. The distinguished alumni will be represented with a display of those receiving the recognition in the South Gym lobby, with a permanent plaque displaying the names of those honored. Soon, nominations will again be accepted for the Caston High School Distinguished Alumni Class of 2013. Anyone who would like to submit a nomination may obtain a nomination form from any Caston school, the administration office, or the Caston website at www.caston.k12.in.us. Finally, I would like to thank Sharon Morris and Scott Sager for conducting and recording the interviews with our distinguished alumni. The Caston School Corporation appreciates our strong partnership with Rochester Telephone Company and the support RTC provides our schools and the community. Now it's time to meet the members of Caston High School Distinguished Alumni Class of 2012.
My name is Marty St. Clair, and I graduated in 1979 from Caston.
Well, my name is Linda Spangler-Wade, and I graduated in 1965, the very first Caston graduating class.
Angie Dittman-Ritchie, and I'm a graduate of the class of 1982.
My name is Jason Snyder, and I graduated in 1995 from Caston High School.
My name is Kevin Keller, and I'm a Caston graduate of 1989.
I'm Seth Zartman, and I'm a 1994 graduate from Caston High School.
Well, I think there are many memorable moments, but for me, a lot of my experiences at Caston revolved around music, and so a lot of hours spent in choir, swing choir, musicals, and I have very fond memories of those times. I think some of the activities that I enjoyed most at Caston were out of the classroom, the extracurricular activities. So when I was there, I was involved, as I mentioned, in musical activities a great deal. I also was involved with the yearbook, and I think the times that I spent outside of class were actually some of the most enjoyable things.
You know, I thought long and hard about that question, and whether it's reflection on where I am in life, thinking about memorable moments are a little difficult because I just think it all was. You know, at that time of society, going to school was like the greatest thing in the world, all right? We didn't have a lot. I was a farm girl, and there wasn't a lot going on in my life except being at home or getting to go to school and be with friends. So all of those times of being with other students was the greatest time for me, and all of the classes I had. I was really into anything that had to do with music, art, performances. I know as our school started, as Caston began, my junior and senior year, finally got an art class. And that was wonderful because I spent a lot of my childhood drawing and so forth. And being able to have that class was wonderful. I was able to take 4 years of languages. I had 2 years of Spanish, 2 years of German. I greatly enjoyed the language aspect as well, along with my language classes, you know, my regular academic studies. Music was a great part of my life. I was very involved in choir. We had musical performances, Fault and Follies, and in the cast and capers. And being able to be on stage and sing, those things I especially enjoyed. I guess for me, it would be knowing that a group of students came together from four different communities. For me to speak of the academic part and so forth, too many years have gone by, and I, you know, can't recall a lot of specific details. It was all fun. All of the learning to me was a marvelous thing to do. I'm quite a reader, and I enjoyed all of that. But the fondest thing for me had to be the Grass Creek kids coming over to Fulton, and we became North Caston for 3 years. And then, of course, our big competitors were the South Caston kids down at 12 Mile, which was a combination of media and 12 Mile students. And it just opened up such a wider resource of contacts and people to see and places to go, new people, friendships to forge that have lasted throughout my lifetime as well. So, you know, that aspect has to be the fondest part.
My most memorable moment was a physics class that I took. Mrs. Miller was our instructor in that class, and we did a lot of experiments in the physics class. The one I remember most vividly is we made a hot air balloon, and we launched it during class, fully expecting it to come down somewhere on school grounds, and it just kept going up and up, and it took off in a wind stream. And so we all jumped in Mrs. Miller's truck and followed that hot air balloon as far as we could, knowing we needed to get back for the next class. So I think that she wound up putting an ad in the paper to see if someone found it on their fields or somewhere in Logansport, if they could return it to us so we would know how far it went. And I don't think we ever heard about that, but it was pretty amazing. The friendships that I made, I've got some lifelong friends that we try to, when everyone's kind of back for the holidays, try to get together and relive old times and catch up on each other's lives. I would say the friendships more than anything. I would have to say prom. For the first time in Caston, what typically went on at prom time was they would overtake the gymnasium, and they would create it into these amazing decorated sites, and you wouldn't even recognize that it was a gymnasium by the time they were done. But for the first time, our class was the first class that did not get the use of the gym. So we had our prom on the Madame Carroll over in Monticello on Lake Freeman, and that was pretty cool for us that was the first time it was kind of off-site.
Most of the time, when you think of most memorable moments, you think of something that was a good time, a good memory, something like that. But I think the most memorable moment that I have from Caston is I lost one of my best friends while we were at students at Caston. Ryan Hubenthal was one of my close friends. Not only was he a student and a peer in my class, but he was also a member of a football team, basketball team, and we were really close. And I think I remember one of my fondest, most memorable times is just spending time with him and my other friends. And you know, when we lost Ryan, that's something that even to this day I'll never forget. And he was involved in a car accident, and I think that even though it's not wasn't a good thing that happened, I think all of our friends and his family all grew from the experience, and you know, just always hoped and prayed that other people wouldn't have to go through that. But it's something I'll always remember, and it is very memorable from my time at Caston. I think what I enjoyed most about being a student at Caston was just the fact that it was such a small school that you really got to build relationships with the other kids there and your peers, and you knew the teachers pretty well. And I grew up going to large inner city schools in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and in Birmingham, Alabama. So Caston was a big change for me, and I really enjoyed the small feel that it had. I made some amazing friends, and you know, got really close to them, and I'm still in touch with a lot of those guys and girls from my class. And I think that's just one of the things that really stands out from my time there at Caston. I think my most fondest memory while being at Caston was playing football for the Comets. We were a pretty small team. We didn't have a lot of numbers, and you know, but we went out there and we competed, and you know, those were the years when North Miami was just a powerhouse, going into state champions and or going to state championships, and you know, we always had good battles with them and Pioneer, and I think just being, you know, in that conference, playing basketball, playing sports and athletics at Caston is very fond memory. I think the support that the community had was amazing, and we really enjoyed having basketball games with packed gyms, and you know, football games on cold October nights was just something that'll, you know, always stick with me.
My most memorable moment at Caston was in my junior year when we won homecoming. We had a great team that year with Brett Heiser and Brian Hoff as linebackers, and a big offensive line that included Ray Eber, Randy Ullery, and Tony Paul. There was a ritual of singing the school song around a tree across from the football field. Thankfully, the upperclassmen knew about it because Caston hadn't won a home game in a long time. We didn't even realize the ritual existed. What I enjoyed most as a Caston student was the opportunities that only came from being in a small school. From athletics to school clubs, it wasn't difficult to get involved. In a larger school, I might not have been able to excel in athletics or be a student council class representative. These opportunities allowed me to develop a confidence that I still have today.
You know, I would have to go back and say, I think I have two moments that really stick out to me. The first moment for me would be as a sophomore winning the sectional championship as a sophomore and being part of the varsity team. You know, back then there was not class sports in the state, so that was a really big thing for us, you know, to be able to accomplish that. Then I think the other one for me was being named a starter my freshman year for the baseball team. You know, as far as I know in recent Caston history, that had never been done before, and a classmate and myself were very fortunate to be able to accomplish that. So those are two moments for me that really stand out, you know, being the athletic guy that I was, stand out really, really in my mind as my time here. You know, I think one of the things, again, that stand out to me being a student here, the first thing that stood out to me, I think being a part of the school corporation was the teachers. You know, I can remember going through elementary and even up through junior high and high school. You know, you had teachers in my time here that really cared about what you were doing as a student. But we also had teachers that really cared about how you were doing as a student. And I think that I think that really was a big thing for me, you know, coming through. I also think one of the great things about being a part of this community was that you knew everybody. And people will tell you I'm a very outgoing guy, and I don't think I know a stranger. So that was a lot of fun, you know, growing up, knowing a lot of people, getting, you know, being in the community. It was just a great thing to be a part of, you know, here. I think being involved in athletics was a huge part. When you're at a small school like this, you're involved in multiple sports. And my fondest memory, I believe, has to do with the athletics. You know, going from basketball to baseball during that time of year, and I think you always had something to look forward to, you know, in that realm. But I think another great thing about being here and being involved in athletics was the coaches that we had, you know, during the time that I was here. You know, I was very fortunate to have coaches who were very involved, who understood the sport and understood what it took to be successful at those sports. And not only did they understand that, but they instilled that in their athletes. It wasn't coaches who were all yell and, you know, it's all about winning. It was all about getting better. And I really enjoyed that, you know, and probably was one of the foundation points of where I'm at today and why I'm doing what I'm doing, but was just very fortunate to be a part of an athletic program where the coaches cared more than just for the wins and losses.
When I graduated from Caston, I went to Butler University in Indianapolis, where I got a degree in chemistry and environmental studies. After I left Butler, I went on to the California Institute of Technology, or Caltech, where I did PhD work in chemistry. While I was in graduate school, I was fortunate enough to meet the woman that's now my wife, and we were married in graduate school. And after we graduated from Caltech, we took a position at Occidental College in Los Angeles, where we taught and did research for a year. And that kind of gave me the opportunity to find out that I actually enjoyed college-level teaching. We then moved to Iowa, where my wife teaches at Cornell College, which is nearby. And I took a staff position at the University of Iowa in environmental engineering. So I worked on the research side of things for 4 years. And then in 1993, I came to Coe College, where I am currently a professor of chemistry. Since I've been here, I was chair of my department for 9 years, and then I was associate dean of the college for 4 years at Well, but now I'm back to being a full-time chemistry professor. I got a taste of teaching when I was in graduate school. We had the opportunity to be a teaching assistant for different levels of courses, and then the opportunity to teach full-time for a year at a small liberal arts college was what really made the decision for me. And then when we moved to Iowa and the opportunity became open at Coe, I think I had the first application. I think I was interested in science from a very early age, and I'm not quite sure why that was, but I do remember in fifth and sixth grade, Mr. Ball, Barton Ball, was the science teacher. And I remember he went out of his way to make sure that I was engaged and that there were materials available. And I think that was kind of a critical time when for many students, science either is fun at that stage or it becomes a chore, and Mr. Ball made science fun, so I appreciate his efforts there. I think in a lot of ways, Caston helped me achieve my goals by offering opportunities, both in the classroom. I think I got a good, solid, basic education there, but also offering those extracurricular activities that kind of filled out my personality and gave me a chance to try out some different things. And it's kind of funny that I was thinking about this, and in many ways that opportunity to stand up on stage and essentially perform, that's what I do every day now, is stand up in front of a group of students and try to keep their attention and teach something. So I think those kinds of activities are actually of great value. I think the most challenging aspect of what I do now is just trying to find ways to grab every student and engage them with the material. I teach a subject that a lot of people think is quite difficult, and I have to overcome challenges, I would say, that students bring to the class, attitudes, and it's always a challenge, but it's an enjoyable challenge. I think you need to take some time to experiment, find out what it is you like to do, and then if you have the aptitude and the ability to do it, my one piece of advice would be to be persistent, because even if you have the ability, there are times that are going to be tough along the way, and being persistent is critical.
This has to be one of the longer parts of my story. Because after I graduated, I did go to Manchester College, and I did go for secondary English, planning to teach English someday, because I had a great love for languages, for English, for writing poetry. I wrote a lot of poetry through the years, and it was a toss-up. Do I become someone in writing, because I wanted to write that great novel, or do I become an artist? Well, it seemed I was a little more successful with the languages part. I was there for 3 years, and my husband-to-be in the Air Force, was getting out, and we just decided, you know, marriage had to be the thing. And so we did get married, moved to New Jersey. At that time, I did get a job in a fiberglass curtain factory, and that was not a very pleasant job. Lots of sticky pieces of fiberglass. And while I was working there, the people that I worked with learned that I had had 3 years of college, and they said, well, you know, you could get a teaching job. And I said, how could I possibly do that without a degree? And they said, well, parochial schools, meaning the Catholic schools in the area, and there were a lot of them, they needed teachers all the time. So I handwrote letters, because that's the era. I handwrote letters and mailed them off. I had a couple of calls, and on the second interview, after an hour, I was hired to teach fourth grade in Pompton Lakes, New Jersey. And it was a very enjoyable experience. I was really kind of unprepared. I'd gone through 3 years of college to teach secondary of English, hadn't had the first education class in my life. But the Sister Sylvia there, had confidence in me. She saw something in me that said I would be able to handle a class of 35 or 36 fourth graders. And I did do that for 3 years. So then life led me along other paths, and eventually I find myself in 1981 with a newborn baby and two older boys, all three boys, and a marriage that failed. I knew that I had to get myself into a situation where I could support my children. I knew I had that wonderful wealth of 3 years of college that couldn't be taken away. And so I did go back to college at IUK, Kokomo, for 2 straight years, full around. And those years were wonderful years of learning. I went from being a BC student at Manchester College, fresh out of high school, to a Dean's List student at IUK. You know, my life experiences had given me confidence, had given me knowledge, had given me determination to meet my goals, and I did. And even before I got my diploma, I was called by administrators here at Caston to come in for an interview in 1984. I did this with one class still to finish, and they hired me to work here. And more of the story goes on. So I, you know, wound up here at Caston thinking I was going to teach for a semester only, and then I didn't know what I was going to be looking for or what I might find, with three small boys to take care of. Well, it just so happened that the Indiana legislature passed the prime time bill, and they lowered the amount of students to a teacher. So 1 week of school I spent with first graders, I guess it was. And then the next week, no, it was the other way around. So I spent 1 week with second grade students for a maternity leave. The following week, I'm in an empty room practically that I had to quickly put together, and I had a full-size first grade classroom. And I have been here at Caston since then, and I have taught first grade, second grade, third grade, fourth grade, currently fourth grade teacher, and I've also spent 3 years as an intervention remediation teacher. I think my career chose me, really, because as an 18-year-old student, I thought I was going to teach English in high school. And I can recall a devastating conversation with Dean Garvey, I think was her name at Manchester. And she said, whatever makes you think that you're going to teach English, you don't know enough about the language itself to teach it, something to that effect. So devastating, I went home, of course, in tears. And then, you know, my story is, as I went on, was that I wound up teaching in a parochial school, you know, for 3 years with fourth graders. And I think at that time I realized I like this. I can relate to children. I can do this. And so when the time came later in my life, in my mid-30s, to go back and finish education, I knew I wanted to go to elementary education. You know, I think that all of my teachers impacted me in one way or the other. Coming from my generation, education to a community, to a family, was very important. And your goal as a student was to listen to the teachers and do what they said, to do your best, to persevere, to carry on, to always work to improve yourself. And of course I had favorite teachers, but I just really can't think of any teacher that didn't contribute some way into making me a better, more rounded person. Our teachers, and you have to understand, I'm looking at a North Caston High School reflection. Our teachers were probably what I would say were demanding teachers. They had a curriculum. They expected you to know it. They expected you to learn it. They expected you to be highly attentive. They expected good products. Now, I loved art. I had it for 2 years. And yet that art teacher was so professional and demanding that one time in my senior year, I got an F for the 6 weeks grade. I had a portfolio due. I think I was only short one or two pictures. It was a pretty extensive portfolio. I never thought she would do that. You know, I thought, I have 98% of it accomplished. But the teachers here were very expectant of good performance, and so was our principal, Mr. Cameron. Time, preparation time. I spent a lot of time after school and weekends coming up with more creative lesson plans. I like to put a lot of thought into it. I like to use learning styles to the extent I can. I like to challenge my students. And of course, with learning about Google.com and all of that stuff, I pull in so many things from the internet that supplement my lessons and make them more interesting and visual. You know, these kids are highly, as our principal likes to say, that, you know, they are highly digital children, and they're not the same kind of students that 10, 15 years ago, they're just not there. Another thing that is difficult, and that I think reflects the change in society, would be discipline and special emotional issues that students can have. You know, I think now is even greater time for trying to figure out, you know, the psychological aspect of children and how they think and what they're bringing to the table, so to speak, from their families. Well, that's a big sigh, because education is changing rapidly, just really rapidly. I mean, there are teachers I know who have chosen to exit before I am, because the demands are becoming so much more legislated. There is a lot of stuff coming out of, I shouldn't say stuff, because never use the word stuff when you're writing, but there's just so many things coming from the state legislature that we are going to have to become more exact and more transparent and more on the line, more in the face of the community. Parents have access to just about anything that we are doing in the classroom. And I'm not saying that that's wrong and that's bad, but we just have to be more on our toes, more organized, just a lot of mores, I think I probably want to say. Be ready to persevere, because it is not easy. Be ready to be open and transparent to your administrators, to your community in whole, not just the parents. Be ready to get into the whole technological world of education, because, you know, the books and this and the writing and so forth, it's changing so much.
After graduation, I went to Purdue University for a year and a half, majoring in accounting. During the summer between my freshman and sophomore years at Purdue, I met my husband, Steve, and elected not to go back after that. So I then, later in life, decided to go back and finish my education, more so from the perspective that I wanted my children to know that I was completing something I'd started, which was important to me as kind of a life lesson for them. And I also wanted to further my education. So I graduated from Ivy Tech in 1997 with an associate's degree in accounting, and then went on to Goshen College and graduated in 2004 from there with a degree in management information systems. So when I left Purdue in 1984, I got a job working in a local bank in the Kosciuszko County area as a teller. I worked there for 2 years, at which time I then transferred to Lake City Bank, where I've been employed for 27 years, or it'll be 27 years in October. I started there as a teller and then worked my way up through the ranks to that of Senior Vice President of Operations and Technology today. Well, I think my career chose me. My dad happened on an ad in the local bank when I was done with school and came home one evening and said, hey, there's an opportunity at Farmer State Bank in Mentone for a teller. And so I went in and applied and got the position. And then after that, I enjoyed what I did, and I've always had a lot of opportunities for growth at Lake City Bank. And so I've just kind of kept going through the ranks to where I'm at today. Not so much on my career decision, but just in furthering my education and finding something I was passionate about. That's the one thing I thought about the teaching staff that I had through the years, was they had a passion for what they were doing, and that kind of bled off onto the rest of us. So that as I grew older, the teachers had a lot of influence on me. Not that I recognized at the time, but as I've recognized throughout the rest of my life. And I would say the classes that I took my senior year, those teachers were the most impactful to me because they challenged us and challenged us to be the best student that we could be, to further our education past high school. And together, I think that that's, I would say through the course material that I took, the classes that I took in high school were not easy classes to take at the time. I took a lot of math, I took a lot of English, social studies, physics, and through learning and taking those classes, it just helped me to set goals and to achieve those goals to the best of my ability. And I've always been a lifelong learner. That's something I think it speaks volumes through the way I kind of pursued college through the years, and the fact that I've also gone through the Graduate School of Banking through Madison, Wisconsin, and also am a graduate of the Leadership Academy in Kosciuszko County. So education's always been important to me. Staying current with technology would be the most challenging aspect of mine. Things I liken banking to the weather in Indiana. It's ever changing and never very predictable. So through the years, I would say the technology and staying current on the new aspects or new innovations coming in banking is the most challenging. I would say to be a leader worth following. It's important to me, all of the individuals for which I have responsibility at the bank. I have 6 direct reports and then 34 indirect. So those are individuals who report up through those 6 managers. And I wouldn't be where I'm at, and I wouldn't be able to do the things that I do or accomplish the things that I've accomplished without each and every one of them. And it's important to recognize that I'm not a sole individual working in that job. It's everyone around me helping me be the success that I am today.
After I graduated from Caston, I enrolled in Manchester College, and I originally started in computer science there and realized that that was working too much by myself and not around people. So I switched over to education, and I graduated from Manchester with a Bachelor of Science. I got a teaching degree in elementary education, and also got minors or endorsements in math and in science. And then after that, I went to, actually while I was in college at Manchester, I went to Fort Benning, Georgia. I enrolled in the Army National Guard, and during my summer, my sophomore, between my freshman and sophomore year at Manchester, I went to Fort Benning, Georgia, where I went through, you know, my basic training and my infantry training there. And then, after that, you know, there's Fort Knox, Fort Leonard Wood, Fort Stewart. Then went back and got my master's degree from Olivet Nazarene University, and then went back to Ball State University to get my second master's in administrative license. So there's a lot of training and education during that time. So after I graduated from Manchester College, I was fortunate enough to do my student teaching here in Rochester, and that was at the middle school. Got to do some science and some math student teaching, and fortunately for me, there was a position that came available that next year in science, and they offered me the position, and of course I took it. I loved Rochester, going to Caston and being a Caston student, I spent a lot of time up in Rochester, and knew a lot of kids from Rochester that had graduated here the same time I had. So I started teaching here in Rochester, and then after that, after September 11th, I was called to go for active duty to Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri, and that's where I spent probably 6 to 8 months down there. It was probably closer to eight, going through nuclear, biological, and chemical weapons training. And after that, I got back, and about 2 months later, I was being deployed overseas for Operation Enduring Freedom. And 3 months after that, I was headed to Kuwait, and got to Kuwait January 1st of 2003. Ended up being there for a couple months. Then we invaded Iraq on the 23rd of March, and I was a part of that invasion with the 293rd Infantry Division, or 293rd Infantry Battalion, out of Fort Wayne, Indiana. Spent some time in Iraq, and then came home and went back to teaching. Was called again to active duty for a second deployment. During that time, we deployed out of Fort Stewart, Georgia, and was with the 76th Infantry Brigade. And we deployed to Balad, Iraq, which is up in the northern part of Iraq in the Sunni Triangle. Spent a little over a year there, and then came back and spent 2 years over here at the high school teaching biology, and decided that I would like to pursue a career in administration. So I went back and got my administrative license, and there was some turnover here with the superintendent and the principal at the time becoming superintendent. So it left me a wonderful opportunity to become the principal of Rochester High School, where I'm very happily employed, and love being here as well. So initially, going into the career of education, it was really simple. I loved being around kids, and I loved working with students, and the military, Pete, I kind of see my career as being twofold. I see it being as an educator and also as a soldier. So the soldier aspect came about because my father was in the military. I grew up on an Air Force base and traveled around with him. Both my grandfathers were in World War II, both in the Army. So I really felt the need to serve my country in that aspect. So I liked the leadership aspect that the military provided and the challenges that it provided, and I gained a lot of confidence doing that. Then on the educational side, quite simply, why did I choose that career path? As I mentioned before, I started out in computer science, and I was working by myself in front of computers all the time, and I like to work with people. I genuinely like to solve problems and help them solve problems, and education's a great place for that. It's a great place to work with students, and I'm blessed now that I'm working with a great faculty and students. So, you know, I think it all boils down to just being and working around people. To be perfectly honest with you, I think the person that's had the most impact in my life, in any kind of choices that I've made, has been my father. My father was a 1965 Caston grad, and that was South Caston when they were down in Media. In fact, I was looking at yearbooks the other day, and boy, it's just neat to see the generations that have gone through that school. But back to the question, I would say that he's had the greatest impact. When I was in Alabama and I was going to school in Birmingham, he was living up here, and I was coming up and visiting during the summer, and we used to go by Caston a lot, and he used to tell me about when he went to school at Caston. Granted, it was a different location. It was still Caston. I really came up to Indiana because of the high school, because of Caston. I was just another number in the school that I was at in Alabama. It was such a large school. I didn't know half of my classmates. I didn't know third of my classmates, and I was a pretty social guy, but I loved the thought of going to a small school and to go to the same school that my father had gone to. So he's really what influenced me to come up here, and boy, I, you know, had just a great time at Caston. I learned a lot, and I, you know, really kind of go back to that decision that I made to come up and go to school at Caston as being, you know, very important, and he influenced me on that. So I think Caston helped me achieve my goals because there was, there wasn't a lot of distractions at Caston. You know, it was pretty straightforward. You had your classes, you had your teachers, and you had the students and your friends that you were going to school with, and you had the athletes or the sports and things that you had. There wasn't a lot of, the schools that I went to, we had a lot. We had gangs. You know, the times that you spent outside of school, a lot of times were either doing something to stay away from the wrong crowd, or you know, getting mixed up with the wrong crowd, and there was always that pressure at all the other schools that I went to. You know, I never had any pressure like that at Caston. So I think Caston really helped keep distractions out, focus in on my education. I learned a lot. You know, when I went to college, I felt like I was very well prepared, and it was a very good experience for me. By far the best educational experience that I had had up to that point, where you know, being in three different cities and three different states, it was by far the best experience that I had. I think the most challenging aspect of the career paths that I've chosen have been separating the professional career with the private life or the family life. Two deployments in Iraq, you don't take family with you. You don't physically take them with you, and that's always hard on family when you're not around, and you can't be around, you can't communicate with them. So the military aspect really requires a lot of time away from home. And that's always hard, very challenging. I would say on the educational side and my current position, still very difficult to juggle that, because you spend a lot of time at school, you have a lot of additional requirements, supervision requirements and duties and things like that, all of which are enjoyable but take time away from being with your family. I think that's something that I've really tried to focus on my first year in as principal, is continuing to make time for my family and get my family involved in the things I'm doing here at school. But it's definitely not easy. And I think another real challenging aspect of this job you know, you really got to stay focused on what your vision and your mission is, and I really want to do what's best for the kids in all the decisions that I make, and unfortunately that doesn't always make everybody happy. So it's a challenge to try and make people understand that what you're trying to do is in the best interest of the kids. So that makes it difficult sometimes. I would say advice for the career path that I've chose. We'll start with the educational piece. Spend as much time in the classrooms as you can prior to pursuing anything administratively. Be a teacher. I know there's some people that go to college right after high school to become administrators. I think it's invaluable the time that you spend in the classroom, the time that I spend as a teacher in the role that I'm in right now. I have a much better understanding of what our teachers are doing and how hard they're working. So that would be my biggest advice, is teach first, then do administration if you ever decide to choose that route. As far as the military goes, my dad would tell you to join the Air Force. I personally like the Army, that's not the advice I would give you, to join the Army. My advice militarily is take every challenge that you can if you're in the military. If you're in the Army, you know, attempt Ranger school, attempt Airborne school. Give your take a chance at as many of those opportunities as you have. And you know, it's one of those things where when you get out of the military, or if you decide to do something in a civilian career, you're going to be that all that experience and that knowledge that you got is going to be nothing but a help in anything that you do. You learn leadership, you learn self-discipline, you learn teamwork, you learn how to work with others, and I think really the biggest thing that I learned was that, you know, quitting isn't an option. And I meet with students quite often, and I try to share that with them when they're ready to give up or they're ready to quit. The military always taught me that's just not an option. You just can't do that. And you fight through and you get through it, and then in the end you're a lot stronger and you know what you can handle, and you know you can make it through about anything. So I guess, you know, simple advice, but that's what I would have for you.
I initially went to Indiana University planning on physical therapy. When I didn't get in, I decided on exercise physiology, eventually getting a bachelor's and master's degree. Because of that experience, I eventually decided on medical school, which I was accepted at Indiana University. I first started working at Methodist Hospital after finishing residency, but my wife and the love of outdoors took me to Colorado. I got to work in a hospital that is surrounded by mountains and deserts and has an abundance of activities, yet the hospital is the largest hospital between Denver and Salt Lake, so I am continuously exposed to challenging cases. I decided on anesthesiology because I enjoy being in the operating room. I like putting people to sleep and taking people's pain away with a well-placed needle. I especially like the day-to-day challenges that come with anesthesia. While looking back on my time at Caston, there were several great teachers, even though I may not have realized it then. One teacher that helped influence my career choice was Mrs. Deanna Miller. Not so much for medicine, but the sciences in general. She was a fantastic chemistry teacher. She gave me the confidence of being able to compete academically with other high-achieving students. This helped me throughout all of my training, especially medical school. Caston helped me achieve my goals by giving me a solid foundation of education to take on college. I felt that I was just as prepared as any of my classmates. I did not ever feel that I was at a disadvantage just because I went to a small school. This was never more apparent than in medical school, which I found initially to be very intimidating. The most challenging aspect of my career is that my job can be unpredictable. On most days, things are very boring, which we like. However, for whatever reason, things can happen quickly, take a turn for the worse. The most challenging aspect of my job is keeping myself prepared for these rare events. My advice for someone from Caston who is thinking about a career in medicine is to go for it. Don't ever use where you came from as an excuse for not achieving. In medical school, I was initially overwhelmed, but quickly realized that I was on an even playing field, if not better prepared than many of my classmates. Don't worry about the current climate of healthcare. It is a challenging and rewarding profession, and most of your patients are actually grateful.
After graduation, I was very fortunate and blessed to get a baseball scholarship to go play at Bethel College in Mishawaka, Indiana, and was able to be there for 4 years, and had a great time playing baseball, had a great career there doing that, also able to get my education, graduated there in 1998, and after graduating Bethel in 1998, went on from there to a few different things. But I graduated in 1998 from Bethel with a business administration degree and a coaching minor. And, you know, after that, then, like I said, my career at that point took a couple different moves, and a couple different things happened there after Bethel. And but spent a year after graduating Bethel in 98 working in corporate America for a small company in Fishers, Indiana. And that didn't last too long for me. I found out real quick that wasn't the career path that I wanted to be on, and was very fortunate at that point to the opportunity to get back into baseball, and through a series of events was able to do that in 1999, and the rest is history from there. Like I said, after leaving Bethel in 1998, I went on to work for a small company in Fishers, Indiana called Custom Expressions. I was hired there as the office manager and took care of everything, day-to-day operations within the company. It was a small company, and I did that from 1998 to 1999. Through my time there, realized that type of work was not for me. I think leaving Bethel, you had these aspirations that, you know, I'm going to get a big time job and I'm going to make lots of money, and at that point, you know, that was kind of the path I was on, you know, and I wanted to work my way up and be able to do that. But through that course of that year, realized that my love was still with baseball, and my love was wanting to get back into baseball. I wanted to be a coach, and in the summer of 1999, got an opportunity. I was able to stay in contact with some people and coaches within baseball, and in the summer of 1999 was given the opportunity to go to Kentucky, to Mayfield, Kentucky, a mid-continent college at that point, and to interview to start their baseball program there. The college had never had athletics before, and they were looking to go into the liberal arts realm. I went down to Kentucky, interviewed, and long story short, ended up getting offered the position and got hired there 2 weeks before school started. And that's where my career started in baseball and in the coaching, and was able to put a team on the field that first year in the spring of 2000. And as they say, the rest is history from there. And I spent 4 years at Mid-Continent College and started the program there, was able to build the new baseball complex there as well during that time. And in the fall of 2003, came back to Bethel College in Mishawaka, Indiana, to take the reins of the baseball program there. And that is where I am currently, and have in my ninth year there, just about to finish up. And so that's where we're at this point. You know, it really started in college. After I left Caston and was able to get a baseball scholarship, and going on to college where, again, I was very fortunate to end up with a great coach, and who still today is my mentor. It really started in that realm, being involved in Bethel College baseball team. And I really knew at that point, coming out of Bethel, that I really wanted to try to stay in baseball if I could. Through a series of events, it just didn't happen right away. But the coaches that I had were just a great influence on me. Were a great influence, you know, not only in my personal life, but a great influence of what kind of career I was able to have on the baseball field. And I knew at that point that I wanted to do the same thing. You know, I wanted an opportunity to try to mold young men, not only to be the best that they can off the field, but to be the best that they can on the field. And that's really the main reason that I chose the path that I'm on at this point. I don't know if I could pinpoint one certain individual. What I can pinpoint is, again, from the time I started playing athletics at a young age, at 4 or 5 years old, I was really fortunate to have you know, dads, my dad, who coached us in those younger years, but all the way up through, you know, in the elementary years, into junior high years, into high school. The coaches that I had, like I said, were very influential on what we were doing because they cared more about your development. They cared more about you learning the fundamentals of how to play the game the right way, whether it was baseball or basketball. It didn't matter the sport. And through that process and then on to college, you know, just the coaches that were willing to give you an opportunity. They didn't look at other people as better or worse. They looked at everybody as an equal opportunity to earn a position, to do the things that they were doing athletically. And I've really appreciated that, you know, throughout my years, you know, in the younger years, getting that foundation and coaches who did it the right way. And really, you take that into your own career and you look back on those experiences and think, you know what, I was very fortunate to have those guys who did it the right way. And that was a huge influence on me, you know, going the way that I have gone at this point. You know, I think probably the most challenging aspect is the recruiting. Recruiting is a never ends. It's a 12-month, 365 job, you know, and when you look at the recruiting process, you know, I tell people all the time, I hear more no's in my job than I do yeses. And, you know, I think there are times where you get yourself geeked up as a recruiter and you think, you know what, I've got this one nailed. And then all of a sudden you can get that phone call and, you know, they're going to turn you down. So I think over the years, that's been one of the most challenging aspects of my profession to deal with. And, you know, again, you're always learning and you always are finding new ways to accomplish what you're trying to do, new ways to approach families, new ways to approach the athlete on how you recruit them. I would say the other aspect that's difficult at times too is you have a new group, a new team every year, and you're trying to take 24 to 27 guys every year and make that team mold together for that particular year. And the challenging part about that is getting to know those individuals and getting to understand how they tick. And then when you understand how they tick, now you're trying to take that and mold them into a team. You know, baseball is a very unique sport. It is a team sport, but there's also a lot of individual things that go into the sport. So it's getting that group to understand what it means to be a team first and foremost. You know, one of the things about baseball, and a lot of people may or may not understand this, but you're dealing with a lot of egos and a lot of pride, you know, in those athletes. And so when you're taking young men who have been the star of their high school teams for 2 or 3 years and you're bringing them to a college setting, now you have a whole group that have been the stars. It's getting them to understand that there's still roles to play in a team situation. And once we can try to master that, now we're on our way to making that team mold into the group that they need to be as they go out on the field of competition. I think a couple things. I think the biggest advice that I would tell people is if you're looking to get into this profession, you know, if you're looking to get into a profession that's going to make a lot of money or that type of thing, this is the wrong profession to get into. If they're looking to get into this profession, I would say that you have to understand that this is not a regular 40-hour week job. The hours for this job are very irregular. You know, you could spend 60, 80, 90 hours a week sometimes doing what you're doing. The other thing I would tell people is you're on call 24/7. You know, at any moment things could happen, and you just have to understand that. Whether it's a call from a player, whether it's a call from a parent, whether it's a call, you know, from other aspects of your job, it really doesn't matter. But, you know, my biggest advice for somebody looking at this profession is you got to love what you do. And I tell people, you know, all the time that if you're excited about getting up and going to do what you do, it's not a job. And you really have to love what you're doing, you know, to be a part of this profession. It takes a lot of time, takes a lot of commitment and dedication to what you believe in. But it's a very rewarding profession. I believe that wholeheartedly. And but I think the biggest thing for me to tell them is that understand it's not a regular 40-hour week job.
Well, to this point in my life, a lot of my time has been spent chasing my children around and attending their activities and being engaged in their lives. But my oldest is a sophomore in college and my youngest is a senior in high school. So I think that phase of life is about to end. And I read a lot. I walk my dog. I'm involved in some community activities as well. My work does involve some outside activities as well. So I speak about some of the work that I do here at CODE outside groups and work with some outside groups on water quality issues. I've also been involved with church in Mount Vernon, and I recently became a member of the board of the Southeast Lynn Community Center, which is our local food bank.
I've always been interested in my community. Rightly or wrongly, thinking that we can make it better, I've been involved over the years with Lions Club and, you know, doing some benevolent things for the community. Been involved in organizing and running festivals for our town of Fulton. Those are hobbies to me, you know, because they take a lot of involvement and a lot of time. Personally, I do much, much reading. I don't have a Kindle yet. I still like to flip those pages. I'm a gardening enthusiast. I'm very involved in my church, musically as well at church, and I also belong to Fulton County Choral Club, which has a large group of ladies, and we sing, you know, usually free gratis at different places. So that's just an extremely important part of my life, to be able to be involved. And if, you know, I was that way in high school, and I still am today. So, you know, the music, the things that you do in high school like that, you carry them with you throughout your life. Probably the biggest thing in voluntary would be organizing our community festival. We started in 2000. Well, actually, I had a group of gals that worked with me back in 1975 for about 3 or 4 years. We did the whole bicentennial thing and started Fulton Fun Days at that time. So when our Lions Club started back up, chartered in 1999, we said, yes, we'll do a festival, and we've carried it on. And we are a very small group, and I had to pull out some volunteers and family members to help me on the planning for this year. But we're looking, you know, to get a lot of exciting things done. It's a very family-oriented type of thing. I've also written a lot of grants to bring things to our park, our basketball court, play sets, and different things like that. I also serve on the Township Advisory Board, and I have for a number of years, probably about 4 terms. So that always has a few little wrinkles and things that go wrong or need to be righted in the community.
Well, I have 3 boys who are very busy and involved athletically through the year. So we have been a member of the football parents group for over 14 years at Tippecanoe Valley, and just encouraging and supporting that my children and their athletics has taken a lot of time. I am also involved in a couple of boards for non-for-profit agencies in Kosciuszko County. I'm an avid reader. I just finished the Hunger Games series in a week's time. I love to read when I get the opportunity, but I've not had as much opportunity lately to read as what I'd appreciate, but those are the things that I do. Well, I graduated from the Kosciuszko County Leadership Academy, and part of that responsibility is to complete a white paper project, which had me and 2 other individuals that we were a group. We represented Kosciuszko County in the communities, greatest communities in which to live in Atlanta, Georgia, several years ago. I'm also involved with the board of directors for both the Beeman Home, which is a shelter for women of abuse and children and their children, and also CASA, which is court-appointed special advocates. I'm on the board of both of those agencies and serve as treasurer in that capacity for both boards.
Well, my hobbies and family activities are changing right now because I've got a 1.5-year-old, almost two, and we have about a 7-week-old right now. So what I'm learning is that our activities and the things that we do as a family are no longer the same things that we did 2 years ago. And it's great. We're really enjoying it. But some of the things that we like to do, my wife and I and my oldest daughter, we love to spend time outside. So we've got a nice big yard and a pond out there. Love to go spend time out there. We love to spend time out on Lake Manitow. And my father's got a little cottage out there, so we go out on the boat and spend time there. When it's just myself, I've got a lot of hobbies. I enjoy anything really outdoors, but I enjoy hunting. I really enjoy shooting, scuba diving when I can find a good place to do it. My family still lives down in Alabama, so I spend some time down there, not nearly as much after taking this job, because there's a lot less vacation time involved in it, but we go down to the beach down there, and I like to do some scuba diving, some offshore fishing, and some things like that. So I'm really an outdoors kind of guy, and so is my wife and my kids. So as far as community service goes, I really, I support a lot of different activities and organizations. Anything that I can do in the community to help, I try to do. Camp Weekend always sticks out, and unfortunately I haven't been able to be involved in that in the last couple of years because of my schedule and my time commitments, but for years I really enjoyed doing that. I loved working with those kids and the counselors there. They really provide a great opportunity for those kids. Last year we did Students Supporting Our Troops, which we have had some students who wanted to do something for soldiers that were overseas or soldiers here in the community. And they came together and just asked if I would help out, and they did all the legwork, but we had fundraisers and drives, and we were able to send over last Christmas a ton of stuff. We worked with Blue Star Mothers out of Plymouth, and that's an organization that anything that for our veterans and soldiers that we have serving, I really, really enjoy doing. And there's been a lot of cancer fundraisers and things in the community as of recent, and well, not even as of recent, for years, and I always try to help out with those as well. Relay for Life, I know that we're gonna be doing some things. They're asking to do some pie in the face type things for the principal here, and I think I'm going to ask my assistant principal to take care of that one for me. But there's so much this community does that I can't even list all of the great things that you see come through here. And I think one of the nicest things for me is that I get to see every fundraiser that passes through this building, and doggone it, most of them, 9 out of 10 of them, are for somebody else. They're fundraisers to benefit someone else. So granted, I can't be involved in all of them, but approving them and supporting them and helping them any way I can really, really means a lot to me, and makes me feel really good to be in a community like this.
I live in a great place for outdoor activities that I regularly take advantage of when I'm not at work. I'm an avid mountain biker, trail runner, hiker, and skier. The whole family enjoys summer camping, which is my favorite thing to do. There's an ongoing need for anesthesia services in developing countries all over the world. Last summer, I was able to go to Peru, and I don't mean Peru, Indiana. There, we put kids to sleep who needed eye surgery. Next year, I'm taking my daughter to maybe Ecuador or back to Peru.
Probably the biggest stress relief for me, and people say I'm crazy for saying this all the time, but it's actually going to play golf. That's my stress relief. That's one of the hobbies that I thoroughly enjoy. I also enjoy getting on a boat and go fishing. I like to do that as much as I can. As a family, we love to camp, and that's a big thing that we love to do every year, and we try to get as much of that done in the summertime as we can. But in all honesty too, is just being at home and spending it with my wife and my kids. My kids love to go out in the backyard and just play, and we could be playing soccer 1 minute and hitting the baseball the next minute, or hitting a volleyball the next. It's just an array of things that they love to do. So really, the family time is really huge for us. Camping is our favorite thing to do, as a family. But my kids also love to go to the pool or the lake, the beach, you know, go swimming, you know, that type of thing. And, you know, honestly, we also enjoy spending time with our extended family as well and getting together with the cousins and the brothers and sisters and just catching up a little bit. So those are some things that we love to do. Very involved in my church. My wife and I both are volunteer in our youth program at church, teaching Sunday school classes, junior church, that type of thing. Our kids are very involved with the WANA program and that type of thing. So that gives us a lot of opportunities to be involved there with their community service-wise, involved with Food for the Hungry. Also do some things with the Boys and Girls Club, you know, some different things throughout the year from that standpoint. My team and I also do a nursing home ministry. So we have nursing home that we visit two or three times a year. And it's just a time for us to meet with the people there and, you know, brighten up their day. You know, let them ask questions, you know, just hang around with them for a little bit. And that's a big part of what we're trying to do at Bethel. Community service is a huge thing for us. We're also involved each year in a day of work service to the community. So we'll send guys out to different organizations that need help doing different things. But those are some of the key ones that we like to try to get involved in and do some things with. And
I think it's the same answer any teacher gives. It's the accomplishments of my students. The highlight of my day is when I get an email from a former student updating me on what they're doing, and I take a lot of pride in their accomplishments.
Something quite simple, but something of great might to me, and that is when a child says to me, "Mrs. Wade, I hope you're my teacher next year."
It's hard to pinpoint one accomplishment over another. I would say the fact that I've worked my way up through the ranks within the bank and had the opportunities that I've had. But the biggest sense of accomplishment for me personally is I managed a conversion project last year, culminated a two-year project in which we looked at our core banking provider and converted over a weekend. So we moved every deposit, every loan, every customer account from one software solution to another. And then following, and along with that was their internet banking, their debit cards, their ATM cards, and that all had to occur over a weekend. And we were successful in the fact that we didn't have any negative impact to any of our customers, which ultimately I felt was probably a measure of success, and had shared with our board of directors, with our senior management team at the bank, that if we could do that, then we would be successful, and we were.
I think my biggest sense of pride as of recently is just being a father. The military kind of didn't allow me to really start a family for quite some time. But it's something that I've always wanted, I've always looked forward to, and I know how much my father meant to me and my mother meant to me, and just the fact that I finally got that, I think is one of the greatest accomplishments of my life. On a professional side of it, I feel like I'm serving my country not only in the military, but as a principal and as an educator in a public school, I get a great sense of accomplishment pride that I can give back to my community, that I am serving something greater than myself. I feel like I'm giving, I'm not doing this for myself, and I didn't serve, you know, in the military for myself. I did it for a greater good, something that I really strongly believe in. And you know, whether it be as principal of Rochester High School or as, you know, Captain Snyder in the United States Army, both of those are being a servant to something greater than myself. And I think that at night, you know, I sleep a little bit better knowing that at least every day I'm trying to do what's best for the community and do what's best for our country in any decisions that I make. And you know, when it's all said and done, I'll look back and really be honored to have had those opportunities.
My biggest sense of pride is my work ethic that allowed me to graduate from medical school while raising 4 kids. My wife and I look back on those times and wonder how we did it. Of course, this accomplishment couldn't have happened without a lot of help from family and friends.
The biggest sense of pride for me is being a husband and a dad. I was very fortunate to meet my beautiful wife in college and to go home every day and to see 3 little faces smile and run to you and give you a big hug, you know, that puts everything else in perspective. And I would say that that's the biggest pride that I have, is being able to be a husband and a dad. And I'm very blessed to be in that position. And I love my kids, I love my wife. And, you know, I would say from the job standpoint is seeing my players graduate, seeing my players accomplish what they came to college for. And, you know, knowing that they've been able over a 4-year span to get to play the game of baseball and they've gotten better doing it, but to see them walk across that stage with a diploma in hand, that's a great sense of pride for me.
I think you need to take advantage of the opportunities that are made available to you. Try things out, take a class that you may not think you're interested in, give it a chance, and then you need to just take advantage and run with those opportunities.
I guess probably refers back to that one that I just did answer. And that is that there's always choice. There's always a second chance, a third chance, a fourth chance if you need it. We do make mistakes in life. We do make choices and decisions that carry consequences that sometimes we don't want to live with, or we wish we could go back and change. Perhaps we know we would have done it differently, but we didn't. So we learn and we go on. You know, that's a character development. If we choose to let it be a character development, we get better. We go on and reach for new goals in order to maintain our own dignity, for one thing, and in order to help others.
The one piece of advice that I would share with current Caston students is to, again, find something you're passionate about and find a way to get paid to do that. That, I think, is a measure of success in anyone, is that we spend more waking hours in our career and with the people with which we work than we do with our own family members. And if you love what you're doing, to me, that's the largest measure of success you could have. I would say never give up on your dream. I think I'm a prime example of that because of the fact that I started college right out of high school, elected to sit out for 4, 5, 6 years, and then go back and finish my degree. You should never give up on your dreams, and that would be the one bit of advice I would give to anyone.
And the one piece of advice that I would give with Caston students is, you know, there. I mentioned how Caston's a small community, a small setting. That certainly doesn't hold you down or tie you up and keep you from being successful in anything that you do. You know, if anything, if you take away from Caston what I did, you will work hard and you basically the sky's the limit. So I guess my advice is, you know, don't ever sell yourself short. Don't ever you know, give up on a dream or something that you have. And you know, I truly believe that it all boils down to hard work, and if you're willing to work hard at something, you'll be successful.
The one piece of advice that I would share with current Caston students would be to be proud of where you came from and be proud of where you're going. A Caston experience is a great way to start your careers.
I think the biggest thing for me is be very respectful to your teachers, your peers. Be honest. do the right thing. Have a plan. If you have a plan, if you want to go to college, it starts right now. Taking your grades seriously and do the best that you can do in the classroom. And if you understand that, you know, I think those things are going to get you a long way, you know. And that's been a huge thing, you know, as we get older, you understand those things more and more. But I think the biggest thing for kids today is just to be honest, be respectful, understand that the people around you are trying to help you, and they have the best intentions for you. And I think that's a huge thing today. If they can grasp that concept, but do the best that you can in the classroom, because that's where it's going to start.